Penguin Random House Audio presents To Wake the Giant, a novel of Pearl Harbor, by Jeff Shaara. Read for you by Mark Bramhall. This book is dedicated to Dan Martinez, National Park Service Chief Historian for the World War II Valor in the Pacific National Monument, which includes the USS Arizona Memorial, Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. His support and generosity opened the door to the extraordinary resources and research that allowed this book to be written. War is not an act of God. It is a crime of man. Cordell Hull, U.S. Secretary of State, 1933 to 1944. To the listener. Throughout our history, certain dates have had enormous significance, serving as reminders or even symbols of an event that profoundly changed our world. In American history alone, there are those dates taught to every student: July 4, 1776, June 6, 1944, November 22, 1963, September 11, 2001. And there is one more: December 7, 1941. On that day, in a mere 2 hours, an aerial assault by the Japanese destroyed or damaged much of the American military fleet and air power in and around Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. This story covers a full year, from December 1940 through the events and horrific tragedy of December 7, 1941. It is a story of sincere efforts to avoid a war, confronting sincere efforts to start one, as well as a story of both heroics and blind incompetence. And it is a story about people on opposing sides, both old and young, who are men of character and courage, men with keen insight and brilliance, and others who are men of immense ego, incompetence, and an astonishing level of blindness. But there is no one villain and no single hero. One challenge in telling this story is to avoid judgment of the participants on both sides. Many, or even most, Americans were encouraged by the media to believe that the Japanese were funny little people or a godless horde, as though they were a swarm of insects. I have inserted throughout this story actual quotes from various officials that, with our benefit of hindsight, display astounding ignorance. But such racism went both ways, as many Japanese viewed many Americans as rich, fat, and lazy, spineless and weak, easy targets who would recoil in terror from any aggressive attack. And thus do wars start. I did not expect how personal this history would become. My goal always is to dig into the minds of the characters so that I feel comfortable putting words in their mouths. My greatest priority is to do justice to those who earned it and to let those men or their families know they are not forgotten. To Wake the Giant is told mainly from the points of view of three men in three very different locations. In Washington, D.C., Cordell Hull is President Franklin D. Roosevelt's Secretary of State, the diplomat responsible for bridging the dangerous gap between the United States and Japan. As such, he is exactly in the middle between Roosevelt, the American military chiefs, and the Japanese ambassador. Hull understands, more than anyone else in his government, that it is his duty to ensure good relations between the United States and every other country on Earth, including, of course, Japan. In Japan, Admiral Isoroku Yamamoto, a political moderate, is confronted by the growing power of the militants in his own government who advocate for war against the world's great powers. Knowing that Japan cannot win such a war, he must ensure Japan's survival by any means necessary. And thus, Admiral Yamamoto devises a plan, a bold strike against the Americans that might grant Japan the time it needs to greatly strengthen its military. In a small town in northeast Florida, Tommy Biggs is a 19-year-old with a talent for baseball and nothing else in his life. The Depression has crushed much of rural America, and Tommy's father is one of the victims. Enduring his father's chronic anger and his mother's despair, Biggs aches for a way out. The opportunity is unexpected, but Biggs suddenly finds an escape from the miserable poverty that engulfs his family and his community. Throughout this story are several other points of view and many names, known and unknown, yet all of them are important to these events. I have taken liberties that must be mentioned, or you'll certainly mention them to me. In the Japanese language, names are given as last, first, Yamamoto Isoroku. In English usage, obviously, it is the other way around. Realizing that the number of Japanese characters in this story might cause some confusion, I have adopted the English standard, first name, last name. In addition, though the Japanese use the metric system, meters, kilometers, etc., for clarity's sake, I have employed the American system of feet and miles. If this book is ever printed in Japanese, I'm certain they will make the necessary changes. I hope I am forgiven. A total of 335 men survived the destruction of the USS Arizona. When I began working on this book in early 2019, there were exactly six of them still living. As I write this, there are two. As you hear this, there could be fewer still. Or none at all. If there is one good reason for me to tackle this story, it is this. We must know, we must understand, and we must remember. Those who were there can no longer tell their own story. Finally, my apologies for a bit of self-indulgence. The creation of this book has been a surprisingly difficult experience. Without trying to over-dramatize this, there were times when the story simply became too emotional to write, or too consuming to stop. That has happened to me a few times in past books, but not as often as it happened here. I deeply appreciate the support and tolerance and affection from my family, my wife, Stephanie, and daughter, Emma. They've put up with a lot during the writing of this book. I hope I can make it up to them. Jeff Shaara, April 14, 2020. Introduction. In many ways, World War II in the Pacific begins with the Japanese victory over the Russians in 1905, the Russo-Japanese War. The level of swagger that results from Japan's decisive end to that war is passed on to a younger generation of officers who embrace an unwavering belief in Japanese military superiority. In 1931, that belief is a primary justification for Japan to invade and occupy Manchuria, China. This blatant act of aggression draws immediate condemnation from the Western powers, though none is willing to commit military assistance to China's defense. The ease with which the Japanese secure such a large area of China, and insert their own puppet government, seems to justify the wisdom of their strategy. It is as though by accomplishing their goals, they prove those goals correct. As the more militant voices take control of the government, Japan's Emperor Hirohito still holds sway with a spiritual and emotional grip on his government and military. But the emperor, by all accounts a meek and mild-mannered man, will not insert himself directly into politics, though he objects often to the practices of more aggressive generals, he does little about them. This paves the way for nearly 15 years of domination by Japan's military, leaving it free to push forward its own aggressive strategic planning. Emboldened by its initial successes in China, the military plans a grand strategy that will spread Japanese influence, if not outright control, over most of Asia. It is driven in part by the need for natural resources, including oil, rubber, and metals, most of which Japan does not have within its own borders. But a growing racism also drives these goals, particularly the belief among many Japanese that they are a race superior to those they seek to conquer. These include the Koreans, who have already suffered under Japanese rule for decades, the Mongolians, the Southeast Asian peoples, and, of course, the Chinese. This notion of Japanese racial superiority extends beyond Asia as well. Many in the Japanese military assume that the West lacks the courage to stand up to Japan's aggressiveness.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.